Hi guys, I'm Kate. Welcome to Weekend Service. We're going to be starting with some worship and going into a time of teaching. And it's so good to have you guys here. I have one quick announcement for you, and that is if you are an 8th grade or a 7th grade lady, make sure you're checking out our Instagram, seeing what's going on each day and the fun activities that we have. With that, let me start us in a word of prayer and we'll get right into worship. God, thank you so much for tonight and for this weekend and for the time we get to spend in your presence. God, I ask that you will just invade the homes of each of these students with your spirit. Give us a calm and a wonder and just an appreciation for who you are. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Come on.
The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive.
Say what? Come on.
He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way. That you have saved me, and oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious name.
Yeah.
Oh, happy day, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
Amen. I truly believe God has given us reason to celebrate and find victory in him every single day. God is good no matter the circumstance. Remember that. Remember, he is always faithful. He's always true to his word. We get to worship him in spite of how we feel, in spite of how we may think things are going, in spite of our pain or our worry or our doubt. He remains faithful. He remains good. He remains constant. Let's remember that as we sing, as we worship together. Let's put our trust in him. Sing, give me faith.
Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life.
So give me faith to trust in you.
Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life.
Sing, I may be weak.
I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Oh, you never fail.
So give me faith, give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. God, we turn our attention to you once again, knowing that you are good in all things, that you never, ever fail. God, give us the faith that we need to trust what you say, to know that these things that we learn about in your word, the things that we're taught about in Scripture, they're not just stories. This is a time where we really get to put it into practice and tell ourselves that you really are who you say you are, that you're faithful in all things, that you're always good in all circumstances. So God, once again, we come before you and we ask that you would speak to us, that we would learn something new about you, that we would grow in our relationship with you. And God, that our faith would be evident in the things that we do and the way that we live. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hey, junior hires, how's it going? Thanks again for joining us this weekend for our second online service. I'm so excited to hang out with you tonight. Hey, a lot of you have been to Whitewater. I love Whitewater. And I want you to know, probably about 12 to 15 years ago, we were on a Whitewater trip and we were having this great time. And you see, back then, there was kind of this tradition. When junior hires went to bed, the adults would go and hang out, and there would be a place where, it's crazy, hasn't happened since then, but bears would sometimes come and just kind of hang out in the kitchen. It would kind of be like black bears. They weren't as scary, and I don't know why, but we had this tradition. We would sometimes go and put chairs out and kind of watch the bears from a distance, knowing we were safe, but it was kind of a typical, normal thing that kind of happened. Well, we had just put the students to bed, and you know, at Whitewater, we sleep out in the open. You know, and we're hanging out and we see a bear going in the kitchen area. We're like, no way, bear. And so some leaders are coming down, and I don't know what happened this time. I don't know if there was something off on how we spooked this bear, but the bear got a little scared as leaders were approaching, and the bear took off toward the students. The students weren't far away, and there it was, just a sea of beds on the ground. And all of a sudden, this black bear starts walking slowly over students, over the junior high boys, okay? And it even stops, kind of looks around, sniffs a boy, and freaks out that boy. You know, they'd been asleep for a little while, and then the bear takes off. And oh my goodness, it was a crazy night. We're like, this had never happened in the history of Whitewater. And now we have some freaked out students that happen to get woken up by this bear. And now we have leaders that are freaking out going, what are we gonna do? And I was stuck in this situation. See, I hadn't been leading Whitewater that long. I wasn't the pro yet. And so I was faced with the decision, what do I do next? And I remember I had different veteran leaders. I had veteran pastors coming, Trav, here's what we got to do. And some of you guys are like, well, Trav, what's the big deal? Here was the big deal. One, I had to figure out, how do we make sure that bear doesn't come back? Two, it's like, hey, how do we protect our kids? How do we keep our students from not freaking out? Because we still had two more nights at Whitewater, and we were going to be faced with, how do we get them to where it just ruins the next 2 days? And on top of that, you know, we're going to be driving home, and how do we make sure our parents aren't freaked out? You see, I was faced with a pretty crazy situation trying to figure out how to do this, because if I didn't do it right, we might not be doing Whitewater ever again. And you see, we are coming to a part in our Daniel series. You see, Taylor last week kind of started us off in chapter 1, talking about these boys who left their, you know, actually didn't leave. They got taken from their homes to this new place, and how they were able to, in the midst of that, able to still honor God, and God rewarded them. And we come to chapter 2, and we find a story where Daniel, he is going to actually be faced with a pretty impossible situation. So if you have your Bibles, open up to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2 is toward the middle of the Bible. Hopefully you guys are there. And we come to this verse 1. We come to chapter 2, verse 1, chapter 2. It says this. In the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled and he could not sleep. So the king summoned the magicians, enchanters, sorcerers, and astrologers to tell them what he had dreamed. So the king has a dream. In fact, some of us think he wasn't sure for sure what he dreamed, because we're going to find out right now. It says right this, when they came in and stood before the king, he said to them, I have had a dream that troubles me, and I want to know what it means. Okay, that was typical back then. Sometimes there'd be dreams, and these astrologers, there's these sorcerers, the enchanters, these magicians, that was their job, was to kind of, hey, tell the king what to do. What's going on? And it says, the astrologers answered the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will interpret it. And that was kind of typical back then. But the thing is, the king replied to the astrologers, this is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me what my dream was and interpret it, I will have you cut into pieces. And your house is turned into piles of rubble. Okay, that's pretty insane, because we know, who knows how to tell somebody their dream? Normally they would tell you a dream, and this was pretty impossible, pretty crazy. Okay, and it says right here, but if you tell me the dream and explain it, you will receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor. So tell me the dream and interpret it for me. Now these astrologers hear this, they're freaking out. It says right here, once more they replied, let the king tell his servants the dream and we will interpret it. Hey, tell us the dream. Hold on, you're crazy. Tell us the dream so we can interpret it. But the king answered, I am certain that you are trying to gain time, because you realize that this is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me the dream, there is just one penalty for you. You have conspired to tell me misleading and wicked things, hoping the situation will change. So then, tell me the dream, and I will know that your interpretation is true. It's kind of cool because, listen, I can tell you my dream and you can give me interpretation. Especially if you're an astrologer, I give you a dream, okay, you can make up any crud you want to. And I have no clue if that's from God, if that's from you, no way. So the king's kind of wise here. The king's like, listen, how do I know you're not lying to me, that you have the right interpretation? It's kind of wise, but kind of a crazy request. Isn't that crazy? Well, he goes on, it says, when the astrologers answered the king, they said, there's not a man on earth who can do what the king asks. No king, however, great and mighty, has ever asked such a thing of us. Hey, no one's ever asked us to do this. This is crazy. There's no one that can do it. They even went on and said, what the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among men. This made the king so angry and furious that this is what's crazy. He says, then he ordered the execution of all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree was issued, put the wise men to death, and the men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put him to death. Uh-oh, I just realized. Now that they made him so mad, he is going to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And we just know at the end of chapter 1 that Daniel and his buddies were wise men of Babylon. That's where they got to be. They were some of the wisest of all of them. And so Daniel's put in a difficult situation. What does he do now? What does he do now in the missed situation that it looks like seems pretty impossible to me? Hey, listen, I don't know what you're going to be going through, and I don't know what impossible situations you might go through, or situations where you seem like you're in an impossible situation. And I was trying to rack my brain, what are impossible situations that we might go through? You know, the simple ones in junior high that don't seem simple at the time could be your friends turn your back on you. And you're like, dude, I had this sweet crew, my homies were hanging out, and all of a sudden they turn your back on you, and you're like, what am I going to do? I was thinking, if some of you, you're already starting to date, and you got your boyfriend or girlfriend, and all of a sudden they break up with you. And at that moment, in that time, it seems like an impossible situation. Some of you, it has to do with just your parents. You do something stupid, you get in trouble, and then all of a sudden they say you can't go to somewhere really important. And at that moment, you think this is an impossible situation. Your parents are going through a divorce, and you're like, this is an impossible situation. I could go story after story of things that seem impossible. I still remember my son Jonathan, just earlier this year, he's at Mission Vista. And he said that after PE, they go into the locker room, and someone from their PE, someone from their PE group was, I guess, throwing a ball inside there or something, but it hit in one of the tiles in the locker room, and the tile came down and shattered, and now the PE coaches are mad. So they take all the guys and they say, tell us who did this. And my son's like, I don't know who did it, Dad. And they said, well, tell you what, if you don't tell us who did it, then you're gonna do this hard exercise that they would normally do for about 10 minutes on a hard day. You're gonna do it for the whole class period. It's a Mission Vista, I think it's like an hour and a half classes. They're gonna do it the whole entire time until someone finally confesses. Well, they went like a week and a half. There are students in the class that are like, this is unfair. They're like, I'm just gonna confess that I did, even though I didn't, because maybe the punishment will be easier than this. And he was faced with an impossible situation. I don't know when you're gonna be faced with something that seems impossible. There's gonna be times in our lives where we feel like we're gonna be in an impossible situation. And Daniel right now is faced with an impossible situation. He is being told they're gonna get killed because somebody can't interpret, or actually first tell the king his dream and then interpret it. But I wanna tell you something. Daniel's able to do something amazing. So let's check out what Daniel does when he is faced with an impossible situation, and I want to let you know, he shows us exactly how we should act or what we should do when we're faced with impossible situations. So if you have the Bibles, keep reading. It's found in Daniel chapter 2. It's the next part. It says this: when Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, why did the king issue such a hard decree? I love it. The first thing that Daniel does, they come and said, hey, that's it. We're going to kill you. We're going to put you to death. What does he do? It says he talked with wisdom and tact. The first thing that he did is he didn't panic. Okay, Daniel's only 17 at this time, maybe. I mean, he's young, and here he has this officer that's going to kill him, and in this crazy situation, he had the ability to not panic. You know, when you're faced with something that seems like an impossible situation, the first thing you do is don't panic. You know what's funny is when we get in situations like that, we tend to panic. And when we panic, you know what happens is we start to get emotional. And you know what happens? When we get emotional, we make stupid decisions. We make bad decisions. In fact, most of us, when we're in these impossible situations, what do? We run. We run from them because we're scared. Imagine if Daniel, the guard came and Daniel just took off. I mean, they'd catch him eventually, right? That's what we do. And what happens is when we start running, and because of that, we get emotional and panic, we start running to the wrong friends. We run to friends who give us the wrong advice. We run to the wrong things. There's people that when they get in these situations, they feel like they have to run to something else. And whether it's the computer and pornography, whether it's alcohol, drugs, we run to something else. And eventually end up running to the wrong things. But not Daniel. Daniel, it says that no, he handled it with wisdom and tact. It's amazing. The second thing he did is, not only not panic, the second thing he did is this, is it's right here, it says here. It says, then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends. You see, he asked the Arioch, he said, hey, can you get me more time? And he actually goes to the king and asks for a little bit more time. And the king said, oh, I'll give you a little more time. And he runs home. And he goes to his buddies. Remember his buddies, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? We'll talk about next week. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah is what they are in their Jewish name. But he said, he urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. What is the second thing he does? First, he didn't panic. But the second thing is he went home to his friends and he said, guys, we need to pray. The second thing he did is this, is he ran to God in prayer. He ran to God in prayer. You know what the thing is? It sounds simple. When we go through a hard time, run to God. Run to God. Run to God. But you know what's funny is why don't we? Why don't we run to God? Well, you know, I think a lot of times when we don't run to God is we don't actually have real faith. See, real faith, Larry used to give us this definition, is trusting God enough to do what he says. And a lot of times, we lack faith. We don't really trust God. And I feel like we don't trust in these situations, so we don't run to God because we don't trust that he's going to save us. Daniel and his buddies, they'd already seen it in chapter 1. No, God could do something amazing, but how come we don't? You know, maybe it's because we prayed before and felt like there was no miracles that ever happened. Maybe it feels like we prayed before and nothing's happened. Maybe it's like when I was in high school and I had hurt in my leg and the doctor said I wouldn't be able to play sports. That was like my life. And I remember I would pray and I was thinking, God's going to let me be injured for a while, but then he's going to do a miracle. And maybe he's going to use this to change you for Christ. And, you know, and I was like excited. Okay, God, this is what you want. So the first month I'm fine. I'm praying 2 months, 3 months. Well, now 3-4 months, a year comes in. Nothing's changed. In fact, the doctor is saying it's getting worse. And now I'm mad at God. And I'm like, God, I've been praying every day. People are said, Trav, do you believe? Do you pray? And I'm like, I'm praying every day. I went to a church where they had a healer come and lay his hands on my leg. Nothing happened. About 9 years ago, my mother-in-law gets cancer. She's supposed to, be able to like, hey, see what we can do, you know, be praying that she gets healed. But you know what? She doesn't get healed. Even just recently, my nephew dies of cancer. And we prayed and we prayed. And maybe what happens is this, is we don't run to God because we think, God, you're not really going to answer my prayers. You're not going to really answer my prayers. You see, it says right here in Mark 11, 24, it says this. It says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it'll be yours. Do we pray like that? Do we pray the prayer of like, God, I'm going to trust you? Daniel said, we're going to pray tonight. We're going to pray all night. I asked for time. It's going to happen. We need to pray. Do we do that? Because see, here's the thing I want you to know is, sometimes we don't understand that God does answer prayers. We just don't always see the miracle. You know, with my leg, God never healed my leg, but I'll tell you this right now. I missed the miracle because maybe God was saying, Trav, you weren't supposed to get healed because you wouldn't be in ministry today if I hadn't done that. And I really believe I wouldn't be in ministry today if God had healed my leg because God had a different plan. My mother-in-law, I don't know why he didn't heal her, but I know this. A lot of her sisters that she'd been praying for years to come to Christ, a couple of them came to Christ because she died. And I still don't know why my nephew passed away, but I know this. At the funeral, there were some amazing things that happened. And maybe God says, Trav, I do answer your prayers. I do amazing miracles. You just miss them. Maybe you miss the miracles. Daniel, he wasn't afraid to run to God. And it says right here, if you keep reading, it says this. That during the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. And then Daniel prays the God of heaven and said this. And he does this prayer where he thanks God. That's the third thing he did. His first thing is he didn't panic. Second thing is he ran to God in prayer. And the third thing is this, he thanked God. I wonder if we ever thank God. You know, I remember when I was a kid, I would ask him to get an A on a test. And I'd pray all night. And then all of a sudden I'd get an A, but I forget to thank him. I remember there's times in my life where I'd ask for crazy things, and sometimes they would come true, but I never thanked God. I wonder if we ever thank God. I love it right here, Philippians 4, verse 6, it says this, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Guys, we need to be thanking. If you read the next section, Daniel has this prayer where he's just thanking God. God, you are amazing. In fact, he kind of points out how to pray. If you want to learn how to pray, that's how you should pray. He points it out. Do we ever thank God? Because here's what I will tell you. We start thanking God, and you know what will start to happen is thank him in everything. It says in every situation, about anything, thank him. When you start thanking God, let me tell you what starts to happen is you start to see the miracles. When I started making a commitment in my life to start thanking him, you know what started happening? Is I started seeing miracles happen all the time. I started seeing answered prayer happen all the time because I started seeing what God was doing in my life. Small things. I'm stressed about an event coming up. I'm stressed about Whitewater. I'm stressed about the situation that happened just I was telling you about, the bear situation. And, you know, God ended up giving me the answer. We ended up dealing with it. And I know that because I thanked him. And I just thanked him for 10, 15 minutes and said, God, you're good. Did we thank him? The third thing is this, and I know we don't have a lot of time, but the last thing Daniel did is when he went to the king with the answer, and you can read it. We won't have time to go all the way through, but it's pretty awesome. What happens is he goes to him, and here's the thing he says. He goes to him, and there's a couple things I just want to show you. First thing he says is this, okay? He goes to the king. And you know what's interesting? This Arioch, that the guard that was supposed to kill him, it's so funny. He goes to the king and says, look, I found the guy that can actually reveal the dream and interpret. Like he takes the credit. But let me tell you what Daniel does. The fourth thing that Daniel did is he gave God the credit. He gave God the glory. It says right here, Daniel replied to the king, no wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about, but there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. Daniel could have said, I did it. Okay, God had just answered his prayer. He had just thanked God, and he could have went and just said, guess what I did? You know what's funny is that's what we do. We take the glory a lot of times. When something good happens in life, I'm like, oh, it was me. But what did Daniel do? You know what's crazy is, show the next verse. The next verse, it's like a couple verses later. Again, Daniel reminds the king, hey, as for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because I have greater wisdom than anyone else. He's like, it's not because of me, king. No, but so that your majesty may know the interpretation. Daniel 2:30. Like he's saying, listen, again, it's not about me. In fact, later on, even reminds him, it's not because of me, it's because we have a great God. It's because we have the one true God. A lot of times when God finally does bless us, do we take the credit? I'm willing to bet we do. And Daniel didn't. Listen, that would have been the one to take. Okay? Not Daniel. And there's so many times in my life where I've gotten credit. I just remember a teacher the other day. I'm a principal. We've just done amazing stuff at this school. We've been doing nonstop. And I'm like, hey, we also want to do this. And she's like, who are you guys? Why would North Coast Church do this? And I was like, hey, I didn't know what to say. I was kind of like, well, that's who we are, but oh man, I wish I would have been able to give all God the glory. Well, let me tell you why. It's because we have an amazing God, and let me tell you how he's blessed us, and let me tell you what's in my life. I wish I had that courage. Do we give God the glory? Do we give him the glory? You see, what happens is in the story, and you can read it for yourself, is he actually reveals the dream. He says, tell you what, you know what your dream is? Your dream is it's about this statue that has gold as the head, and then silver, and then bronze, and then iron and clay. And he said, guess what? Then all of a sudden in your dream, there's like a stone that comes up that's not made by human hands. And all of a sudden it hits the image and the image shatters to pieces. And then that stone, that rock, becomes like a mountain. And he said, guess what? I'm going to tell you the interpretation. This is what God has revealed to me is those are four kingdoms. King Nebuchadnezzar, you're the head. And there's going to be three other kingdoms, which is crazy because you can look it up yourself and look at prophecies. But Daniel's revealing a real prophecy. What came after Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom? The Medes and Persians were the second one, the silver. And then the third thing was the Greeks, which Alexander the Great was like the bronze. And the last one was the Roman kingdom. And he says, guess what? There's going to be another stone not made by human hands, God, that's going to come and shatter those and turn the whole world upside down and set up his throne. And he's talking about Jesus. When did Jesus come? During the Romans. And he gives us interpretation. And he said, guess what? It's true. And it says right there, Nebuchadnezzar praises God because of it. Daniel was faced with this impossible situation. I don't know what you're going to go through, but there's going to be times in life where you're going to feel like you're going through an impossible situation. And Daniel told us exactly what to do. By the way he lived his life, he didn't panic. He ran to God in prayer, kind of enlisted his buddies. He thanked God in everything. And the last thing is he gave glory to God. Listen, read that, check it out. But don't forget, Daniel gives us some wise ways on how we can deal with impossible situations. Thank you so much. Let's pray. Dear God, I just want to thank you so much for this time that we can come together. Lord, I love Daniel. Isn't it perfect? Just we're already going through some situations. Sometimes seems impossible. Sometimes it seems crazy, but Lord, just already the last 2 weeks, there's been amazing things that have already happened. Lord, may we use Daniel as an example of what to do when we're faced with those impossible situations. We love you so much. In your name, amen. Hey, thank you so much for being with us this weekend. We'll see you this Tuesday online for TNL. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Hey, guys. Thanks for watching. If you have any prayer requests, submit them in the link below. Thank you.